Tonight we're going to try and explore questions around how we manage our protected landscapes here in Wales, a conversation sparked, of course, by the work on display in Mike's bleakly beautiful Land Sea exhibition. The exhibition is currently on show at Oriola Park, Pembrokeshire Coast National Park Authority's Landscape Gallery and Discovery Centre in St David's. So without further ado, if you haven't already seen it, a quick plug to go and see it and take your friends. And of course, it is worth mentioning that as we all gather here virtually, there's another gathering taking place which might consider some of the issues that we're going to talk about this evening, at COP26, meeting, of course, in Glasgow. So good luck to them. I have a sense that perhaps our evening might be more productive, who knows. Let me introduce you to all of our panelists. We are, of course, joined by the artist Mike Perry, Dr. Sarah Beynon, the conservationist and founder of the Bug Farm in St David's, star of stage and screen. Ian Rickman is here, the deputy president of the Farmers Union of Wales, and a great pleasure to welcome Dr. Rosie Plummer from Pembrokeshire Coast National Park Authority, where she is a member. In just a moment, we're going to watch a short film about Mike's exhibition. But before we do, I'd like to invite each of our panelists to introduce themselves, tell us something of their background and what they do. Mike, let's start with you. You kick the ball, you get the ball rolling.
Okay, well, I'm a photographic artist, and the show at Oriola Park has been work that I've been working on for about 10 to 15 years. Some of the works have taken the last couple of years during COVID, but some of it was taken way back in, say, 2010. And really, my work has increasingly concentrated on British landscape, but how we look at our landscapes and trying to get people to dig below the surfaces and start to see some of the conflicts and the myths that surround, for example, the idea that our national parks are these beautiful places of wilderness, of unspoilt beauty. My childhood was here in Pembrokeshire, the national park. I spent 30 years in London, but I came back. And just the differences that I started to notice that's happened with nature in my lifetime are so extreme that my work has very much been about that. I think as a contemporary artist, the role of a contemporary artist is to reflect our times. And it's pretty bleak. You said earlier on that my show is kind of bleak and beautiful, but it's not half as bleak as the science, Jamie. So I think, and that's what we're going to be discussing today and what we do about that.
We certainly will. Let's next bring in Dr. Sarah Beynon, the founder of the Bug Farm in St David's. Sarah.
Hello. So as Jamie very kindly said, I'm founder of the Bug Farm. I suppose my interest started when I grew up on a family farm. So I'm a beef and sheep and arable farmer's daughter who had a passion for conservation, thanks to my grandmother, from a very young age, and just developed that over the years, and then worked at Oxford University studying dung beetles and as an indicator of how we can actually look at valuing our wildlife and how we can put that in the framework of viable modern farming, and the two, how they can work side by side. And I think it was that passion of really changing opinion, both at the grassroots level with farmers and consumers, but also at a policy level, that started the Bug Farm, so that I could drive our own research here where I thought we could make the biggest difference. And so we're a research centre where we do the research, we put it into practice on the farm, and then we hopefully educate people about it in the visitor attraction. So it's a real pleasure to be here tonight, because I think Mike and I have very, very similar opinions, and looking at the bigger picture from both the art and the science side, as coming from a maternal line of artists, I think is absolutely vital to infuse people to see that, yes, we're in a really rubbish situation right now, but we can do something if we all work together.
Well, that's very positive, and we look forward to hearing a little more of that a little later. Let's bring in the Deputy President of the Farmers Union of Wales next, and Ian Rickman. Ian.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. I live on a family farm. It's an upland sheep farm near Llandilo, Carmarthenshire, where we farm sheep. We keep sheep, We also graze the common land locally, the Back Mountain. So our sheep go up there in the summer to graze on that. Also, I obviously don't live in the Pembrokeshire National Park, but the Pembrokeshire Coast National Park. I do live in the Pembrokeshire National Park. So I'm used to living in a national park and some of the pluses and minuses of that. As Jamie said, I'm the Deputy President of the Farmers Union of Wales.
It comes a close second, the Brecon Beacons National Park, but it is very much in second place here, and it's unfortunate, but you will be outnumbered in this particular debate tonight. Let's have a final word from Rosie Plummer and your story, your background, and what you do.
Thanks, Jamie. Good evening to everybody, and it's lovely to be here. Thank you for inviting me. My background, it has some parallels. The agriculture and forestry bit is writ large. I was Middle England, but all my childhood was roaming the beaches of Pembrokeshire and beachcombing and climbing and challenging myself. That's ever been my button on my till. Landscapes are very large for me. I'm an NRW board member and I'm chair of the Protected Areas Committee. Like the others, I think the way that Mike's exhibition has drawn our attention, for me as a scientist, from the micro to the macro to the landscape scale, is tremendously important for us all. And it gives us a fantastic discussion point. I regard myself as a bit of a change maker. That's something that really enthuses me, and an educator and a communicator. So let's see how that pans out. Thank you.
Rosie, thank you. Very brave to confessing to be associated with Natural Resources Wales. Extraordinary. We won't talk about that tonight, but we will talk about many of those other wonderful things. Ladies and gentlemen, our panel, you know how to get in touch the usual way on Zoom, so please do so. We're going to hear much more from all of them in just a couple of moments. First, let's watch the film. Here it is.
You don't have to go to the Arctic or Brazilian rainforest to see environmental collapse. It's here on our doorsteps, it's in our fields, our lanes, our hedgerows, and it's here in Britain, and it's in our national parks, places we normally associate with natural beauty or unspoiled wilderness. My work explores how we engage with these landscapes, how we interpret and represent the landscape in this context, and exposing some of the myths and the conflicts that exist.
I grew up in the Pembrokeshire National Park, and the smells, the sounds are in my veins. I love the place, but like most of Britain, nature here is in real trouble. There's hardly any fish left in the sea, which is why the cliffs are virtually empty of seabirds. After a storm here, the beach is completely covered in plastic pollution. The water may look really inviting, but the truth is it's full of toxic microplastics, and this has all happened in my lifetime. look inland and things aren't a lot better. I took a photograph here called Green Gorse. At first you think you're above a luscious tropical rainforest, but as you come closer you realise it's just stubby Welsh gorse. Initially I was attracted by this sort of slab of green colour and against this clear white background, but I was trying to make a sort of monochrome abstraction from sort of monoculture agriculture. It's really just a reflection of, I think, of the lack of biodiversity along the coast here. The National Museum Wales exhibition at Orley Park consists of two bodies of work. My large-scale landscapes, which were taken in the landscape, and photographs of found objects that I've picked up while working in the landscape and then photographed back in the studio. And we've mixed these works together because, in essence, we feel they are both landscapes. The more traditional representations of the land are, in effect, depicting man's impact on nature, and then the smaller one-to-one objects are depicting nature's impact back on the man-made.
It's fascinating stuff, I must say. I mean, I enjoyed the film very much. Mike, I want to first begin by asking you about you haven't pulled any punches whatsoever in your critique of what's happening in the natural world. And the images are so stark and disturbing. And they're not the kind of rose-tinted views of Pembrokeshire that one might expect someone like you, one of the country's leading artists, to shoot in one of the country's leading tourist destinations. I want to ask you, first of all, what made you focus on this particular representation of the landscape rather than showing perhaps, I don't know, where national park conservation efforts in Pembrokeshire have had a beneficial effect?
Well, I think, you know, I could very easily have taken some sort of happier pictures, some more jolly pictures of coloured fishing boats, you know, bobbing around in Porthcawl Harbour and also visited some of the areas where some fantastic micro, quite small rewilding projects. But the truth is the science is so clear, and I think it would have given a disproportionate representation. I mean, the wider picture, the overall picture is one of, you could argue, we're heading towards ecological collapse. Now, those aren't my words. Those are the words of Natural History Museum, the Royal Society, scientists researching this everywhere. Even the United Nations are thinking of withdrawing the nature conservation status to our national parks, and Pembrokeshire included. So this is not my, it's not a personal, it's the facts where the science are pointing us. So I've only got limited space in the gallery there. And I wanted to try and get as many messages across as I could that would start to get people to think again about the landscape they're looking at. It's very much challenging how we look at the landscape. And of course, what I'm up against, it's funny, last night I turned BBC iPlayer on and there's a new series called Lolo in Pembrokeshire, produced by BBC Factual Television. I watched it, it was 40 minutes long. There wasn't one mention of climate change, wasn't one mention of the environment, biodiversity, our water's been, I mean, it was like a fairy tale kind of vision of the national park. And I think this is part of the problem. Any children or anybody watching that type of program would go, oh, everything's okay here. And it's the same with David Attenborough. You know, for a long period of time, for me, he was kind of making these kind of nature porn series, beautifully shot, magnificent. But then he said, no, I'm not doing this anymore. The problems are too great. If you want my series, I'm going to tell the truth about what's happening. And good on him. And look at the impact he's had, which has been fantastic. So I think that's the context, really, for me.
I want to confess to you that I'm one of those people who has, before I went on to a different world, I spent 25 years working for the BBC, and I think I made something like 60 documentaries on landscape in Wales. And my brief would be, strictly between all of us here, warm bath television. There's enough grimness in the world, and there certainly is on BBC One at tea time. You're on BBC Two at 7:30. for God's sake, cheer people up. And the message was very, very clear from program makers. We do not want to have to deal, or you to be dealing with those difficult issues. We want to celebrate the landscape. And that was very, very much the message for a very long period of time. And I have to confess to you, I was one of those people who made a lot of those programs as well. And I know where they're coming from. When I think of people like John Knapp Fisher and John Piper, I mean, I wish I was clever enough to pick up this camera and walk around my house, because I've spent 30 years collecting paintings about Pembrokeshire. Like you, I've spent a lot of time in London. I've worked in the Middle East and all around the world. And part of my mental health resilience about being taken away from this place I loved was to have those photographic and art representations of the place I loved. And I wanted them to be almost a romantic celebration of where I had come from and what I was missing. And I suppose I struggle with your bleakness and your bluntness of what I know to be true.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you look at through sort of art history, I think some of the most powerful art actually, you know, covers sort of beauty and darkness at the same time. And Nietzsche said there's no beautiful surface that doesn't have a darker depth. And I think, you know, Shakespeare's bittersweet. And I think actually some of those powerful art actually kind of gets to the truth. And that's the contradiction being as a human being. The paradox is things can be both beautiful and have difficult narratives. And I go for walks along the coastal path. I walk the dog every night, and it is beautiful in one respect, but at the same time, there's a sense of melancholy now, because I kind of know what's beneath the surface, just how bad things are. So I think the most powerful art, and personally for myself, I can't do work that just skims the surface. I have to try and tell the truth. So if I go walk across the Preseles, I can't point the camera and take an image of a place that I now see as desperately empty, acidic soils, some Sitka spruce forestry there, which is doing no good, and not think this is land that needs to be rejuvenated. We need to start in capturing carbon from it. We need to start getting higher biodiversity. And we need to fundamentally, I think, have a renaissance in the thinking of what constitutes beautiful landscape. Beautiful landscape, surely, when it has to be where nature flourishes. And us humans can enjoy being part of that. So I can't find any, personally, any motivational beauty for just doing pretty pictures that make, you know, sunsets over St. David's Head. It's not been to do it for me. And I think that's what I'm trying to say, really.
You've said it very, very eloquently. I want to bring in Dr. Rosie Plummer here. Rosie, it is bleak stuff. And in a sense, everyone who loves the national parks and loves our landscapes really needs to deal with this and perhaps wake up and be much more honest about what they are and what's going on in them. Because that is basically the message from Mike, isn't it?
Undoubtedly. And I don't think we should, in this forum, kid ourselves that it is anything other than a really serious and important challenge that we all face. But equally, we tend to say, we talk about the people in the park, but we must remember that actually to make the changes, we've got to influence not just the people in the park, but actually everybody, because it is change made by everybody and awareness on the part of everybody that will make the difference. It's not a park set in aspic, it's a living landscape, it's a visited landscape. And part of it is making sure that we're making it accessible to others to understand the challenges that we're facing and to be part of the change that brings about that rejuvenation. I mean, Mike is downbeat, and absolutely, you know, our state of nature reports for the UN and UK are globally absolutely challenging. But at the same time, as Mike says later on in the film, you know, you can see how wildlife and plants can and do thrive if only we give them opportunities. We as leaders have to be positive. Leaders must be visionary and encouraging. Otherwise, we'll all go in a hole and not change.
You know, I've lost count of the amount of stories that we covered in a previous life of mine where change of any kind was suggested in either Snowdonia, the Brecon Beacons, or the Pembrokeshire Coast National Park. I mean, it was a bit like suggesting setting fire to the Vatican. Change of any sort was invariably impossible. And I'm intrigued to hear you suggest that you think that that can happen, will happen, and must happen, because in my experience, change in any national park in Wales is pretty dash difficult.
I take the point, but change is not. Again, we shouldn't be pointing the finger at, oh, it's the national park that's changed. It's all of us. It's every one of us. It's our individual choices and behaviours that need to change.
Let's bring in Sarah Beynon here. Sarah, we've talked many times across the airwaves, and I have to say that I've always come away from interviews with you being cheered with the world, because you're invariably not one of those scientific doom mongers who can be rather depressing to listen to. So for goodness sake, come and cheer us up.
I think the way we do have to look at it is we all know we're in a dire situation, don't we? And I think it's we need to make sure that we're aware of that, that we're taking it seriously. And I think that's the problem, is we've known that we've been in this situation for quite a long time now. And by painting the glossy picture, hasn't always made any change happen. And I do totally agree that we need to take a step back and say, this is serious. You know, the UK is one of the most nature depleted countries in the world. We see the UK as this green patchwork. And it's interesting, isn't it, that we often see something as being green, so a monoculture of something like grass that's green, but that's not the true word of environmentally green. And I think that's how we need to kind of change our attitudes a little bit, is looking at environmentally greening the UK. And you know, it is frightening. It's, you know, some of the figures that say, if we, you know, we've got this, say our 100% biodiversity is where we want to aim at. Some recent work has shown that so long as we can keep biodiversity levels above 90%, then we're in safe levels. We in the UK have lost 50% of our biodiversity. So we're out of safe levels, and, you know, and it's similar across the world. So I think there is time to say, right, enough is enough. We shouldn't be scared of change. And I think one of the big things with change is that a lot of humanity sees change as often belittling what's happened beforehand, saying that what happened before isn't good enough, whether it's farming. You know, if I talk to my father about the way the farm's being run, if I suggest change, he sees it as a direct conflict with how he and his father have farmed. And it's trying to, I guess, change our mindsets and say that change is not saying that what has happened to this point has no value. It's building upon that as we learn more. And I think, you know, I saw some of the comments popping up as well, saying that we do need to enthuse people to say that actually we don't just shut off and say we can't do anything. And the small, I think, I don't know what you all feel, but I've always had people in my life who have enthused me at different situations. And it's thanks to probably about 4 or 5 people that I am enthused about the natural world. So I think we've all got that opportunity to enthuse people around us to do good and make a difference. And that's what I've always believed, that as individuals, we can enthuse, inspire and showcase, as you have done with your programming, as Yolo's done with his programming, as David Attenborough's done, showcase this extraordinary world around us. We just can't lose that. And we need to get people emotionally, people need to watch these and go, we need to save this, and then start the little easy steps and take people on that first journey of planting a small wildflower meadow in a pot or in their back garden, and then we can escalate.
Let's bring in Ian Rickman here. Ian, whenever I do programs on this debate in any part of the world, whenever you introduce anyone from the farming community, they always feel as if they're in some kind of circular firing squad. I wonder how you feel about this debate at the moment. I mean, I'm assuming, like many farmers, you feel under attack. I mean, how does it feel where you're sitting?
I don't quite feel like I'm in front of a firing squad, didn't I? But as an industry, and I talk to fellow farmers, my neighbours down here, we all feel under siege, I think is a better way of putting it, as an industry. And we seem to get, we get the point, you know, climate change is a serious issue and lack of biodiversity is a serious issue. We all need to do something about that. I would argue that farmers are already doing a lot about that. I can put examples from the farm here and other farms locally, but we can always do more and we can always improve that situation. But we do feel that agriculture seems to get the blame. Farmers perceive that agriculture gets the blame for everything. And we perceive ourselves as part of the solution as well as more than part of the problem, I think, going forward here. Enjoy seeing Mike's work. And I think some of Mike's work is fantastic, but it's a different environment than I see when I walk around the farm here. And I wish I could walk you around the farm here virtually now. So this is a typical family farm. Our average field size here is 3 acres. So that's a small field. It's surrounded by hedges. Top of the farm, we have stone walls. We've done agri-environment work for over the years here in various agri-environment schemes. We planted herbal lay this year to increase biodiversity. So farmers are trying to do that work. And we know we have our part to play. And there's some really good work going on out there. But you've got to bring the farmers along with you. And you've got organisations out there such as, and I got to declare an interest here because I'm on the board of PONT, Pori Natur Athreftadaeth, which, as the name implies, PONT. They try and build a bridge between farming and conservation. So we bring everybody along together. We recognise the importance of grazing in the environment. Obviously not overgrazing. A level of grazing that increases biodiversity in the environment. And there's organisations like that and other organisations out there that are doing great work at the moment with farmers. So I've got a positive outlook on it. I think we can get out of this. And I don't see quite such a bleak picture when I walk around the farm areas that Mike paints.
We'll come back and we'll talk more on this in just a few moments. I just want to just briefly touch on again this mention that was made earlier on of the Natural History Museum publishing a report last month that said the UK is one of the most nature-depleted countries in the world, in the bottom 10% globally and last among the G7 group of nations, with an average of about half of its biodiversity left. I want to ask our panellists, how have we in the UK arrived at this unenviable position, and what can we do to reverse the decline? Panellists, in your opinion, what can make the biggest difference? Mike, let's start with you.
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem is so severe here that a little bit of tinkering with the current system is not going to get us out of problems. Making the hedgerows a little bit wider, slightly changing the subsidy system. I think we've got to have a complete renaissance in thinking of what our land's for. I mean, I saw a statistic from the Natural Office of Statistics 2 days ago that 88% of Wales's land is used for livestock, 88%, and it represents 0.9% of the GDP of Wales and less than 2% of the people. So this, you know, huge amount of the land, very few people, the farmers, are having a huge say in how our land is used. So, and the result of that is our biodiversity is in collapse. So I think we need a fundamental change. We need to stop eating as much meat and dairy. We need to eat masses more vegetable, locally produced and served to local markets. And we need to open up huge amounts of the land, which is currently used for monoculture, which is doing no good, for rejuvenation. Some schemes of rewilding, some regeneration, but massively, to get back nature so that we can have a completely new industry of ecotourism. Wales could have some of the most finest nature trails through the center of it in the whole world, which would employ more people, would improve the communities, would actually help the Welsh language because younger people in the communities would stay and get involved in ecotourism. Basically, we need a fundamental change in the way we think about food production, how we use the land.
Rosie Plummer, it all sounds very straightforward. It's down to you guys to implement it. I want to come and chair this meeting where we drive this through. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think Mike makes some interesting points, but again, it's that tendency to blame the farmers do this. No, it's we, the consumers, who are doing it. So it's our choices, each of us as individuals. The bottom line, the solution is ours. is our actions, our choices, and we need to take personal responsibility for being change makers. And that's not just us who live in Wales and what we do. It's the urban population as well as the rural population. It's a global challenge, but we each individually, as Mike says, need to eat more plant. We need to look to the changes that are coming in, which we're going to hear undoubtedly a great deal about in terms of the land stewardship schemes, the change post-Brexit in the payments for public goods, and the changes in use of the land. And the solution, I mean, there's some interesting chats in the bar, but it's not just planting trees everywhere, it's trees in the right places, and looking at the right things in the right places, the way in which we use all the goods around us. But we're part of that, it's not just the farming community.
Sarah Beynon, I want you to address these particular questions. How in the UK did we arrive in this unenviable position? What can we do to reverse the decline? And in your opinion, given your particular background, what would make the biggest difference?
I think in terms of how we've got to where we are, we're very densely populated on a small footprint here in the UK. And so we have been forced by markets. And I think, as Rosie said, it is an individual choice, but it's also a policy choice. And farmers are almost the middlemen and women between policy and consumer choice. And we blame those middle people. Whereas I think we need to be hitting at very much at, like you say, consumer choice, but also at policy. What are farmers being paid to produce, and how viable is that? And I think the problem, one of the reasons why I'm talking, I suppose, more from a biodiversity perspective than a climate perspective, we're not bringing in all the other issues that come from a perspective, is really that the markets over the past 20, 30, 40 years plus, maybe half a century, have been pushed towards production, and production without considering biodiversity. And I think that has had a huge detrimental impact. It's, we're seeing huge technological advances in farming. We're seeing farmers doing their absolute best to, whether it's land sharing and protecting biodiversity as part of a farming business, where they have some productive areas and then some areas that they put towards biodiversity. And then others, who are just trying to produce food very, very efficiently. And others, the other extreme, who are looking more towards that rewilding. And so I think we're in a situation now where the farming community, as Ian said, wants to be part of the solution. And it's the huge amounts of pesticide use, the digging up of wild habitat to grow more food in the past, we're seeing the impacts now. And I think to move forwards, I know I was recently watching the great debate at the Oxford University Museum of Natural History with Charles Godfrey, Lord Krebs, and a number of others. And they were saying, do we need an agricultural revolution? And all of them agreed that, yes, we do. We need a change.
Okay.
Driven by the tools that we have in our toolkit now. We have...
Rosie, I'm going to.
So I think that's the way forward.
I'm going to cut you off there because we're having a couple of problems with the reception on the St David's Peninsula, which you'll be very familiar with. I'm going to bring in Ian Rickman here, and Ian, I want you to address the particular question: what are the challenges facing farming community? What, in your opinion, can make the biggest difference here? How in the UK did we get to this unenviable position, and what can be done to reverse the decline?
Yeah, well, unsurprisingly, I don't quite agree with Mike's view there, that we just go wholesale change from the position we're in now to that this other utopia, as it were, of rewilding and remove all livestock from the land. Removing all livestock from the land is not going to improve biodiversity. I can give you examples from around the end, and there probably are examples of that on the Pembrokeshire Coast National Park. Common land over the road here, which was livestock were removed from it. It's 200 acres. It's an ancient Iron Age hill fort. Livestock were removed from that area. It's part of the Brecon Beacons National Park. So they on how things were progressing, and all that happened is the biodiversity actually reduced, and everyone agreed. Conservationists, Brecon Beacons National Park, but they need a level of grazing back on there to increase the biodiversity. So it's a matter of level, isn't it? It's a matter of getting that balance right between the need to produce food, and we do need to produce food in this country. Yeah. And as farmers in this country, we're very good at producing a very efficient, sustainable. We've got some of the most sustainable production systems in the world. The danger is here that if you stop us producing food, you get rid of all the livestock in Wales, for instance. Okay, right, that's fine. No, where are you going to get your food from? Then you import that food from abroad that is often farmed in a far less sustainable system than we run in this country.
Thank you,
Ian. Sorry,
Mike, I will bring you in there because he makes a good point. Okay, I mean you can introduce this utopia in Pembrokeshire, Wales, the United Kingdom, and deliver what you say you want, and you end up shipping food halfway around the world. That's perhaps one of the outcomes of this debate.
Well, just to clarify, I wasn't saying you take all the animals off the planet or Wales. I was saying we change proportions because at the moment, the bulk of it, okay, we just, rather than eat food all the time, meat all the time or very regularly, we cut down massively our meat and dairy eating and replace with vegetables, which are use less land and are healthier. And by doing that, the meat production or the animal production that's left is done in a much kinder way, much smaller, more environmentally friendly farming, not the sort of kind of mega dairies now that are springing up all over Pembrokeshire. The mega dairies are, I spoke to a couple of rangers at the national parks. They're depressed about the mega dairies. You can't get rid of the slurry. It's filling the rivers for the phosphates and runoff. And they're everywhere. The farm next to me, they're spewing it out into the sea. They've just been fined £40,000. The mega dairy thing is a disaster. So it's not about getting rid of, it's changing the way we farm. So you massively decrease the amount of livestock and sheep and cattle, but where you farm kindly on mixed farms where yes, animals, humans together can create very high biodiversity, but it's a different type of farming. It's about balance.
And I'm sorry. I'm just going to come back in very briefly on Mike and just wonder when you go down to the supermarket in Haverford West and you say to Mrs. Jones from Nail and Look Love, that cheap stuff we had in the supermarket last week, it's now four times the cost. Are you okay with that? I mean, what's the answer?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is why these issues are government issues. It's about education. It's about renaissance in our thinking. Just as we've got a lot of people off cigarettes, we're going to have to get a lot of people off meat and explain the reasons why. Because I think if you fully explain the reasons why, people want to live closely with healthy nature. The COVID experience has shown how much people value nature, but we're losing it. And therefore, I think if people are told about the implications of eating too much meat all the time, they will make those changes. And if they don't want to, we'll have to force them.
Rosie Plummer, I mean, when you hear stories about super dairies pumping effluent into the sea and into rivers, and in fact, the Planning Commission even being signed off in sensitive areas, do you sense that the governance around organisations that should know better is fundamentally too weak?
I undoubtedly there are issues that, and the rivers are undoubtedly the most challenged of our environments. Of course, they flow into the sea. That's a globally shared environment. But as Sarah also points out, we've got an accumulation of many decades of misuse of pesticides, much of which is still in the soil. You only have to look at wax caps. Even after 30 years, you're still seeing the effects of phosphate on the fungal growth in particular fields. It is a real challenge to get the legislation to catch up with and to get the policy to catch up with where we need to be. You only have to look at the great stink of 1865 in London, where raw sewage was flowing across the banks and cholera outbreaks will rise. It takes a while. We must keep pushing. We must push harder for sustainable management of natural resources and the legislation that puts that in place. Changing policy for farming land use is coming, undoubtedly.
I wasn't thinking so much about the great stink. I was thinking more about the stink more recently, when the governing authorities appeared in court just a few days ago to challenge pollution incidents in Wales. And we all know about super dairies being signed off miraculously, planning permission being given for these developments. How does that happen when those planning authorities, whether they be Pembrokeshire Coast National Park or Pembrokeshire Council Planning Authority or NRW, simply seem to be so out of step with popular feeling about these kind of incidents and this kind of behaviour?
I think it's fair to say you look at the planning powers of the Pembrokeshire Coast National Park Authority, which are statutory powers, and it has its local development plan. It's constrained by those policies properly. But tracking the way in which pollution incidents happen, which absolutely there is legislation in place to control, but again, you've got to be able to evidence that. You've got to be able to sufficiently bring a conviction, no different from anything else. You've got to be able to provide the evidence that allows that legislation to take effect. And that's often, I've seen some interesting remarks from some of your folk here in the chat bar, talking about the resource or the power that NRW has or does not have. And that's part of the challenge, you of needing to provide the evidence and the tracking and the monitoring that allows us to bring the convictions.
I'm just going to move on. Very, very briefly, if you would, Ian. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, Jamie, can I just quickly come in there on that point, because I feel in front of the firing squad again as a farmer. If I can just make the point, I mean, we've all seen, and I'm not denying at all that there are pollution incidents caused by agriculture. There are pollution incidents, and we need to get better at doing that, but let's get it in proportion here now. We've all seen the media reports lately of the water companies, but when the rainfall is excessive, they just open the valves and release the raw sewage out into the water as well. So it's not only agriculture that's to blame for all pollution. So I just want to get that one.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to race on, and I know lots of you want to get in here, but you must forgive me, because I need to just move this on, if you would. I want to ask all of you next, all of our panelists. We're talking about rural places. We have been talking about rural places. But of course, in the UK, these aren't areas of absolute wilderness. They're places where people live and have farmed for thousands of years. I wonder what the challenges facing farming communities are in this crisis, and what are the benefits for farmers and rural communities of restoring nature? Let's start with you, Mike. Quick thoughts on this, please, from our panelists.
Yeah, I did an artist residency in the Eland Valley, in that whole area of Powys, which is absolutely the epitome of sort of mown hills. And, you know, I spoke to a lot of farmers, and a lot of them are depressed because the subsidies make it very hard for them. They're not, you know, their children want to leave. They don't want to take on this hill farming monoculture. And I am convinced that a regeneration of the nature, which will take time, will produce much better communities, will employ more people locally. And the examples of where there has been rewilding and rejuvenation, many more people are involved. Look at some of the examples in Scotland, hiring many more people. And so I think actually it's one thing that could massively improve the culture and the communities in Wales if we start to use nature in a way that, if you like, is a value to, as a public good to everybody. I think it's going to be hugely important for improving communities.
Sarah, you will know more than most, coming from a farming background, that lots of people might well listen to this and say, well, you know, the thing is, I mean, we don't want to be conservation people. We want to farm what we do, and it's in the blood. And this is one of those big cultural crashes, isn't it?
I heard most of that, I think. Please stop me if you can't hear me again. I think it is difficult, but I think at the end of the day, we need food, which means we need farmers and we need farming. And so I think it's absolutely vital that farmers are allowed to farm and not seen as being the bad guys for farming. And I think that's where looking at a landscape scale is really important. And I think we need to be looking at farming efficiently and working with those really kind of passionate farmers who want to farm, but just looking at where the issues are with how the farming practice may be impacting climate and biodiversity, and targeting those particular areas to bring the farmers along with us, but not to alienate farmers, because I think this conservation farmer divide has been going on for too long, and I think it needs to stop, because we all need to eat at the same time as look after our wildlife. And I think we need to stop thinking that we're all on different sides, and come together and actually work with farmers to farm more efficiently, and as everyone said, actually look at the solutions to that rather than doing so much finger pointing. I think that's key.
Mike Perry started this conversation about talking about the sea and the empty sea, as he described it, but also the plastic filth and the microplastics on the beaches where he walked the dog in the morning. And I'm keen that we don't spend much more time talking specifically about farming, which is obviously a big issue here, but there is another part of your art and there is another part of the story, and it's about the story of plastic. Sarah, I just want to go back to you again and talk about how you win this war against plastic and the damage that it does. For those of us who don't have your scientific background, understanding how catastrophic its influence is on planet Earth.
I think plastic has just become an inherent part of humanity, hasn't it? Since it's been developed, and we use it in every which way because it's a fantastic material, but comes at, as you say, such an environmental cost. And I think that the problem is that our seas now are becoming, as we see on the media time and time again, they're becoming full of plastic. The fish are eating plastic. It's getting bioaccumulated up the food chain and then right into the microorganisms as well. And so it is then coming into every other part of our life. And I think what we can do as individuals is we can make huge differences ourselves, can't we? Right through from the toothbrush. You know, I'm as bad as anyone else. I suddenly go, I need a new toothbrush. I haven't got around to going and getting a wooden one. Oh, there's a plastic one in the shop. Oh, hell, I'll just buy one more. And, you know, and it's that mentality where we just go, I'll do it tomorrow. You know, and you suddenly think, oh, I'll get toothpaste. I'll just get it in that plastic toothpaste tube. Whereas we've got the options of these different products being available, and we don't need to be buying disposable plastic. I think utilising plastic as a long-term, you know, using plastic that's already in the system and recycling and using it is fine, but disposable single-use plastic is very, very easy as a consumer if you're organised enough to avoid.
Mike Perry, earlier on you were talking about the relative story of how a country was forced to understand that smoking was antisocial, mm-hmm. and we could have a say.
I think I got a gist of that, which is how do you create change with plastic? Is that your question?
Yes.
Well, I mean, I think somebody talked about governance earlier on. I mean, I think much of this has to be led by government, by legislation. And we've had 20 years of governments talking about nudging the consumer. Or we've had this period where particularly conservative governments have talked about nudging the consumer, but they're so highly lobbied by these industries that we'll lose out. That very little's done. We need, this is war, you know, we need to go to sort of a warlike situation. We need to do much more legislation on not just our use of land, but on plastics. And I think if the government really was really serious, it could do an awful lot to try and ban certain types of plastics. Look, Coca-Cola still haven't changed their, you know, they're still using single plastic. I mean, for heaven's sake, it's incredible. So we need legislation and leadership. And I also think even in the national parks, I mean, I'm not sure, you know, the governance of national parks, no disrespect, are fully behind all this, because I've spoken to friends who have had big debates with different national parks in the country. And when I did a tour of the show around Orley Park, no disrespect, but the chairman there questioned whether plastics was a problem. He said the jury's out. You know, I was shocked, you know. And so I'm not even sure that there is that motivation in top legislators at central government and local government really to take these things on. I think it's just starting to happen now. The consumers are and public are getting very worried, but I don't think we've got the leadership at national government or at local government yet.
Absolutely agree with the need for there to be strong legislation that takes, for example, single-use plastic, as it has already for microplastics, taken active steps. But at the same time, the fastest reaction is from personal choices and our personal behaviours, the choices of clothes we buy, the choices, as Sarah so rightly pointed out, the toothbrush you use, the soap and the plastics that you have. Look around your home and look around all the time at the choices that you make, because those are the most powerful.
Rosie, can I just answer that? Before I set up a solar energy company, the ex-head of Greenpeace many years ago, and talking to the Tory government, we tried to convince developers to start insulating much, much higher level. And they basically, the government's got a voluntary agreement with the building industry to start changing. They did nothing, okay? And you can't ask consumers, you have to create legislation. And if you say to an industry, in 3 years' time, you cannot produce this, they will change. But they lobby.
And that is happening.
Yeah, but you can't just rely on the consumer. You need top and bottom.
With respect, I wasn't saying that, Mike. I said governments absolutely legislation have their place and must come in. It's just they're very slow mechanisms. And of course, we vote for the governments. We vote for the authorities that make those impositions. So we are again powerful in our voices, in the way that we make our choices, and in the way we either encourage or require and ask the questions of our MPs, our representatives, and expect them to push the legislation. So absolutely, they all have their part to play. I'm no way saying it's either one or the other. We need the whole panoply.
Yeah, agree with that.
I think this is something that us as farmers need to work really damn hard on, is the fact that we've developed farming systems over the years, sorry about the blackout, there we go, to rely on single-use plastic to wrap up grass, to pickle it, to feed our animals. And to me, that whole process of the biodiversity impact of growing grass super, super early with lots of chemical inputs. We cut it before anything has a chance to flower, super early in spring, and then keep putting inputs, keep cutting, and then wrap it in two layers of single-use plastic to feed to our cows blows my mind.
With you 100% there, absolutely, Sarah. We need to absolutely go back to a different nature of food production on the hoof, and the vegetable production that which many have highlighted, horticulture working with nature. There used to be a very strong horticulture industry in Wales. It absolutely has reduced. However, there's a lot of Wales that isn't suitable, and we don't grow cashews and we don't grow soya. And you know, we have to get that balance right, and not just, as Ian has said, ship out our convenience of buying in the things that we want to places. And you know, you look at the number of goods that involve palm oil. Hang on, we have to make those choices because those are overseas choices. But you're quite right. We absolutely have to get the legislation and our changes in farming systems to get that much more. Look at the impacts of restored meadows and grasslands, and you'll know very well about the insects. I'm a grassland fungi freak. So, hey.
The risk of being in the firing line here again. Can I just, no one can argue the issue of single-use plastics is a massive issue. But regardless of that, if you take it as a farm, I mean, there's a product I produce that would help to reduce the amount of plastic we use in the world, and that's wool. All sheep produce a crop of wool, or all most sheep in this country do, every year. We have to shear the sheep for animal health reasons anyway. But we shear those sheep, we produce a crop of wool, which is ironically has plummeted in value for the last 2 years. The value of my wool clip from my 400 ewes this year was some in the region of £80 for the 400 ewes fleeces. So it's got no value whatsoever, but that's a renewable resource that grows naturally every year. So if we could encourage people to use more wool in their clothes, woolen clothing, except apart from using the plastic alternatives, then that would be great. And that also, as that wool is growing on the sheep, it's also absorbing carbon, so it's a carbon store as well. So it's a win-win at the moment, and it's a frustration to all sheep farmers in Wales, and we have quite a few sheep in Wales, that wool is not a more valuable resource and more use isn't made of it than is at the moment. Because I think, again, that's one of the answers or solutions to the problem rather than the big problem.
Yeah, Ian, on that point, you may think I've been just critical of farming. It's not. It's about changing farming. So my example of a better way of farming is that there's some horticulture, there's some animals where you use the wool for local insulation. It's a brilliant source of insulation, but it's just changing the nature at the moment. It's just such monoculture, both in our forestry, our production of dairy product and lamb. It's about, if you like, a different way of farming. It's not just criticizing the farm, it's about farming differently. So actually, we have a farm here, 80 acres, not very poor land, coastal farm, but it's a tied tenancy, so I can't change it. But one of the things that I'd like to ask you is, there is a culture amongst the farming, some farming community here, wanting to tidy up nature. Like our hedgerows are cut right back every year, okay? Right back, neat and tidy. Now, we know that our hedgerows are critical for wildlife and biodiversity. Why on earth, where does this culture of wanting to tidy up nature rather than let it flourish, where does it come from?
The honest answer to that is I'm not sure, but I get what you're saying. It's an historic thing, isn't it? It goes back to the thing of being being seen to be a good farmer, a tidy farmer. Debate to that is that in a lot of the agri-environment schemes that we've had recently in Wales, Bastia, we've got now Tir Gofal before that, Tir Cymru before that, with agri-environment schemes, which, you know, I was in on the farm and a lot of other farmers in Wales are in. You know, you were encouraging those not to cut all your hedges every year. So you'd cut the hedges every 2 years, some hedges every 2 years. So you'd leave a proportion of hedges each year for the wildlife and the biodiversity. Yeah. So there's a lot of really good work going on out there. So I get your point. That does happen on some farms. That doesn't happen on all farms. I don't cut all my hedges every year. There's a proportion of my hedges that just do their own thing. And grow as they see fit. We've got streamside corridors on the farm. So that's an area we were encouraged to do that under agri-environment schemes in the past, where we've got streams running through the farm. You fence off a 7 meter area either side of that stream, so that keeps the water quality higher. The stock having access to that water, you have given a drink place where they can get access to the stream, so that increases the biodiversity in that area. Either 7 meters either side of the stream is left to do its own thing for nature to do. So that's a small piece of rewilding, if you like. So a lot of that work is, you know, I see in my area, the farms I go and visit, I see a lot of that work going on. So I admit we can all do more. There's always more to be done, whatever aspect of life you look at. But I do see that work going on farms at the moment.
But we can do so much better if we work together than if we divide, because we all want the same thing. We want sustainable farming, food which is produced, which benefits nature, families, communities, carbon sequestration. And those things can be achieved through collaboration. Yes, government has to play its part.
May I just step in there, actually, to say I completely agree, Vicky. And I think there are a number of large collaborative projects, even just the ones that I know that we're involved in the Sir David's Peninsula, going on at the moment that involve farmers, conservationists, and policy level. And I think so there's big projects looking at management of common land, but also not just looking at the problems, but actively saying, we've known what the problems are, we know what the solutions are, we're now going to put action into change, to put change in. And I think there are those projects are really starting to come together.
Thank
now.
You. Yes.
I'm seeing a big collaborative change recently in, and it's often individuals, isn't it? You just need individuals to be a bit of a pain in the backside and just keep digging, keep going. And if you've got enough people who are willing to keep digging together, we can do it. And I think there are enough people. And I think now is a time for change. And, you know, and I think, Heather, you mentioned about education as well. And we need to bring our young people along, don't we, on this journey. It's happening globally. We're seeing it. But we have school groups coming here.
Can I? Sorry.
Are supreme in terms of their idea, their energies, passion. And I think we're on a tipping point.
Thank you. Someone else's turn, but just in one sentence, you know, we have a big scheme which is supported by 50,000 of government money for horticulture short supply chains, but sadly the National Park rejected the application of polytunnels, so one of our key producers has a major setback. So this sort of lack of thing, and there's organic horticulture of course, so we need to collaborate better in not undermining each other when we want to do regenerative food production and not be destroyed by regulations.
I think we've got time for one more question.
David Gardner, if you'd like to unmute yourself, David.
Yeah, hi, thanks for the opportunity. It's been a fascinating discussion, but something I haven't heard yet. We've heard a lot about loss of biodiversity and all of that, but we haven't heard about the loss of the soils and the degradation of the soils, which are currently going on as a result of the intensive agriculture that covers Pembrokeshire. Scientific evidence suggests that the soil subject to this current intensive farming is deteriorating to such an extent it would have been lost and degraded to such an extent it'll be unproductive by 2050. What does Ian and Rosie say about that? What are they doing to prevent that? Because the farmers at the moment seem to be digging their own grave.
Ian, do you want to take first stab at that, or?
Yeah, can I come in there? I just from a personal point of view, then my experience of that. I don't degrade my soils. I farm permanent grassland. Some of these grassland layers have been. I don't plow. I can't plow because there's a lot of rock and stone in our soil, and as soon as you put a plow in there, I wouldn't want to do, you just dig up a whole load of stone, which makes a whole load of work for me and is no good at all. There is things we can do to improve, even I can do to improve my soil, quality soil structure and the carbon storage of that soil, and the biodiversity at the same time. We're trialing at the moment, we put it in for the first time last year, because we grow Swedes on the farm as well, a small area of Swedes every year, for the livestock to eat during the winter. And that's a good thing as well, because that's a different crop. So you've got that, and the different insects and wildlife will make use of that as the sweet grows in the field during the winter. And only 3 acres of sweets we grow every year, just a small, 3 or 4 acres, a small amount. It's not a big scale thing. And that's just one field then. But what we've done this year then, instead of reseeding that back to permanent grassland as we would normally do, we've put a herbal lay in. We're trialing, and it's a full-on herbal lay. It's to me, as a commercial farmer, it looks like a field of weeds, but I'm sure it isn't a field of weeds. So I quite like that because it hides all the other weeds I've got on the farm. I have quite a lot of weeds on the farm. I'm quite good at growing them. So that's one thing we can do. And interestingly, we only planted this herbal lay this year, back in the summer. And we had a guy who's doing a lot of work on regenerative farming, a consultant, and he was on the farm as part of a discussion group. And we took a spade up, and he dug a spade down into the soil, right, of this new lay. We hadn't disturbed the soil at all. It had been direct drilled into the pasture. And the depth of root that those, the plantains and the chicory had already gone down was phenomenal. You wouldn't believe how much. And I know that's what he was explaining to us then. That's improving your soil structure. It's improving your biodiversity. It's storing more carbon. So there's a win. On the soil front from that point of view. So that's just one thing farmers can do, and farmers are doing that around the country now, but perhaps that's more common in the future.
And I would completely agree with that. And we mustn't forget, David, too, the increased intensity of rainfall, which is with climate change, is a key issue. And we need to look towards grassland, more permanent grassland, more permanent soil cover as a key part of the solution. So we're not leaving areas of soil exposed, because clearly, and that is again a change back in the farming methodology to make sure that we are avoiding the risk factors that, as you quite rightly say, are washing off soil, are degrading our soil carbon storage and the quality of our soils. But you know, Ian's very eloquently given you some key examples there.
Yeah, but sorry.
I think we need to start wrapping up.
We do.
I'd just like to sort of try and end on a high or a positive. I've got a good comment in the chat here. Mike, your exhibition had a big impact on me when I saw it, and the images have stayed with me. How do you think that artists and other communicators can inspire us all to make sure the changes we are all talking about? If you could answer that one quickly and then we'll wrap up.
Yeah, I think art has a limited effect. I think we need legislators, and I think the positive action from everybody. What art can do is, if galleries, then curators, take the work and educate and bring schools in and get it, but the image is part of the community, so you get this education. That's how artists can help, working with communities. But I think in the grand scheme of things, artists bear witness to what's going on. To create change, you need fundamental legislation, government, and you need masses of people saying, no, we won't take this anymore. And, if necessary, getting on the streets all for collaboration, Vicky, but sometimes you need positive action.
Okay, thank you, everyone. It's been difficult technical difficulties, so thank you, everyone, for sticking with us. Just want to say thank you to the panellists and Photo Gallery as well for helping with tonight's event. So we'll leave it there. Thank you ever so much, everybody. The exhibition is on till the 16th of January, so if you've been inspired tonight, please do come and see it at Orilla Park in St. David's. Thank you.